as far as scalability is concerned, when you are like dealing with the things like a system design interview, right? Scalability is one of the most important leg in this. System design interviews are mostly like your manager rounds, the last rounds, or maybe a penultimate round by a senior tech lead or maybe an architect, right? In these kind of rounds, you are primarily like asked to implement some real world things like, let's say, Twitter or Instagram or maybe a tiny URL or something similar, right? So in building all these things, scalability is a primary factor. So that is what we are going to see today. So I'll start with some basic concepts of scalability, what all theory is required to know about scalability. Then we'll jump into some problem. Maybe we'll design something from scratch, right? So let's start with this. Yeah, so has anyone seen this thing before? This is primarily the famous Twitter whale thing. So this is not too frequent nowadays because Twitter has scaled a lot. But way down when it was started, Twitter got started, they used to face a lot of scalability issues and all. And when somebody used to like open their feed or something, sometimes they used to see this. So these are the kind of problems we need to solve for handling scalability. So is everybody aware of this guy, Chacha Chaudhary? So let's say on a particular day, he was planning to like go for a lunch to a particular restaurant. So let's say he went there and he was really impressed by the food and all that was presented to him. The presentation was good. The service was pretty fast and the taste and the food was really good. But what happens the next day is that he thought of taking one of his friends with him. And the friend is none other than Sabu. So can somebody tell me what are the issues that will happen when Sabu accompanies Chacha Chaudhary to the restaurant?
So food might not be there a lot for him.
Okay, so food might be lesser as compared to what Sabu's requirement are.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Service will also degrade because they have to give both the guys food.
Right, because again, Sabu would be requiring a lot of things, so the service would degrade. So one important catch over here is that, just think about it. When Sabu is asking for lots and lots of food, it's not only that service is getting slow for Sabu. It's also getting slow for all the other users who are there at that point in the restaurant, right? So everybody is kind of getting affected. So that's the point where we can say that the restaurant was not scalable and it was not good enough to have handle that amount of load of user or maybe something, right? So a very important concept over here for understanding scalability is called a performance. So scalability and performance goes hand in hand. So can somebody tell me what is performance?
So maybe let me give a shot. So it's about having a good measurement of having a positive measurement of how your system functions, right?
Okay.
So, because these measurements can be different in different scenarios depending on the problems which you are solving.
Okay.
So you are keen on certain measures.
Okay.
And not so keen on certain measures, right? And you want to test your system against those kind of criteria because the real world scenario will depend on these things.
Right. So basically, one of the important factor about performance is that how your system is performing is measured by when, let's say, when one of the users is accessing your system, what is the latency of your system? What is the throughput of your system? What is the, let's say, how well the system is performing? So when in the case of one user system, your system is not performing well or your system is not doing well, then your system is set to have a performance issue. Right. So let's say the algorithm or the logic that you chose up, that was not up to the mark. So that's the scenario when your performance is said to be bad. So what about scalability? Can somebody tell me when is your system said to have a scalability problem?
Unable to handle the huge request.
Yeah, exactly. So performance problem occurred when for one user your system was not doing well, but there are scenarios where for one particular user your system is doing well, but when a huge load of users are coming up to use their system, your system fails, your system breaks, the latency shoots. So that's the place where your system is said to have a scalability issue, right? So let's move a little bit ahead. So latency and throughput. Any idea about what these two terms are?
Like latency means when the first bit receives a response for the request.
Sorry, I just missed it. Can you come up again?
The latency, we can tell at what time we can receive first bit as a response.
Okay.
Throughput, like we can say, per minute, how many requests we can handle it.
Exactly. So basically, latency is the amount of time taken to handle a particular request, and throughput is basically the amount of request that can be handled kind of per unit sort of a time. Right. So in any scalable system, the primary aim or the primary goal is to have the maximum amount of throughput that is possible to maintain the sort of a latency limit. Let's, for example, take when you are opening a Facebook page, if it is taking like more than five seconds, or let's say more than 2 seconds to open properly, you'll feel irritated sort of a thing, right? So at that point, you can say the latency is pretty high. Right. So our aim is to maintain gain as much as throughput as we can, whereas maintaining the latency up to a particular limit. Now here, as we discussed, your system is set to be scalable only when even if you are increasing the number of users, you are increasing the load on your system, still the performance is constant. Right. It doesn't degrade as the load is increasing. No, but on the other hand, cost is expected to increase. Now can somebody tell me what, from where does this cost come from?
Keeping servers, if we increase the performance of that server, or increasing more number of server, like physical type of thing, the cost will increase.
Right. So basically, when you are adding more number of servers, or you are using better servers, something like that, right? Any other cost that you feel? So there's not only this server cost, there are other things also come into picture. Like when your load is increasing, people are using more and more of your like website. So they will expect better features and those kind of stuff. And since more load is coming, you need more like workforce with you. You need more employees. That also comes into this cost part. So your cost is expected to increase as and when your load is increasing. These are the two basic graphs for scalability, that performance should remain constant with load, whereas cost should increase proportionally to load. Yeah. So now let's take an example of a very crude kind of a architecture, a very old kind of an architecture, which is called a monolithic architecture. And then we'll look into how we'll add into components to this to make it a very kind of a scalable sort of a system, right? So a monolithic system over here, if you see everything like a database, application, and web server, everything is inside a single machine. There are a lot of people who are calling this machine through internet, and they are getting the responses. So can anybody tell me what all issues can this system face?
If this server goes down by any chance,
a single point of failure.
Cool. Yeah.
Anything else?
And delay also, like everything has been done. Everybody is requesting from same thing. So it might be busy for providing the, so latency will increase for the systems. So it will be giving a response to one machine and other machine might have to wait.
Okay.
Accessing same thing.
Mm-hmm. And right. Yeah. Okay. Continue. Sorry.
And then, yeah, a load, it won't be able to take load much.
Okay, because it's a single server, right?
Yeah. these things.
Yeah, so we are going to face a lot of issues when we have everything embedded into a single thing. So let's move a little ahead from this. How can we solve this problem? What is the first step that you see over here that we can do to resolve this?
The first thing we can do, like we can do the horizontal scaling.
Okay.
Then for architectural kind of things, from we can like go for from monolithic to microservice architecture, like vertical scaling.
Vertical scaling?
Yeah.
Okay. Right. So this is something similar to what we are going to do now. So we start with vertical scaling. So vertical scaling is primarily the point where you are adding up more resources to the same machine, right? At first, what will you do? The single machine that we had over here, what we are going to do is that we are going to increase its RAM. We are going to increase its CPU so that it can handle more and more load with it, right? The same machine. So, but do you think this is going to solve our problems?
Up to an extent, it can solve, but after that, there is a limit on everything. So.
Right. Exactly. So there's a limit on everything. What problems we are going to face by increasing this the RAM and CPU of the machine would be that one important aspect would be there's a finite limit that with which a machine comes with RAM and all, right? And another thing, whenever we want to like increase the CPUs, increase the RAM of the thing, we'll have to shut down our service. We'll have to make changes in the CPU, and then we'll have to make it up again. So that will be a downtime for us. Right. So this kind of a scenario is called scaling up, where in the same server, we are adding more resources. So next thing that we are going to talk about is vertical partitioning, which somebody was just talking about, that we are going to do some separations. So separation over here, the first thing that we go ahead with doing is kind of earlier we were having in the same server, we were having web server, application server, and the database server. Now we sort of remove the database server from it. Right. So what advantage we face from this is that the database server might have different kind of requirements, the different kind of configurations, whereas application or web server might have different kind of requirements and configurations.
One can be down and still whole process will be running.
Exactly. So these two kind of can function independently of each other. So in the next step, we kind of separated web server from app server also. So can somebody tell me what is the difference between a web server and app server?
Like the web server, from the, like incoming request and all, we can handle it in web server. From like any core business logic, like we can separate it into the app server.
Exactly. So basically the primary purpose of web server, or now kind of web server has become an umbrella term for lot many things, like client service, client-based service, or a client service, or a front-end service, or a web service. So basically it kind of handles everything user-facing or the client-facing, right? It doesn't have any business logic with it. It doesn't have any data, mostly it doesn't have any database interactions with it. So it doesn't do any business logic sort of a thing. And separating this from app server, what benefit it gives to the app server is that app server doesn't need to take care of anything related to the client. It doesn't need to have kind of like if else check, like if my client is this, then do this, otherwise do this. That those things are handled by the web server or a set of web server, right? So that is the benefit we are getting by separating web server and app server. Any questions till now? Yeah, so let's move ahead. By doing vertical partitioning, what we did was same kind, like all the nodes that have been created are of different kind. They are handling different kind of tasks with themselves. And what somebody earlier pointed out was the kind of the microservice architecture. So currently, if you see this app server that we are having over here, this itself could be divided further. So let's take example of something like a Twitter, right? There could be separate kind of app servers, one handling like the search in Twitter, another handling like posting of tweets in Twitter, another maybe generating the timeline in that. So those kind of stuff, right? So in that way, we can move into a microservice kind of an architecture using vertical partitioning. Now the next thing that comes up is called scaling out, or the horizontal scaling. Till now, what we were doing is that we were creating kind of a separate node for like each type of task that we need to handle. Now what we are going to do is that the problem that we are facing in that is that what somebody earlier pointed out was there would be single point of failures, and it might be that a single machine won't be good enough to handle all the load. So these kind of problems can be solved out using horizontal scaling, where the same kinds of nodes are replicated, each of the machine having same code or the same database running on it, and it is expected to give the same response as the other machines, right? So typically the collection of nodes may be known as a cluster over here. So this is called scaling out.
Okay, I have a question.
Yeah,
like this microservice. So when we divide vertical partitioning, we did we move from monolithic to microservice?
So we did one part of it. We currently just divided the app server and web server into two parts. But if we go ahead a step further, as we were talking about the Twitter example,
yeah,
then that's called a microservice architecture.
Okay, still we are in micro monolithic. If you say, my question was that.
Yeah, by just doing web server and app server, you're not moving to microservice. But if we divide it into further lot of different components, then it becomes a microservice.
So still now we are in monolithic. Okay, fine.
Right. So further down the line, the example that we'll discuss at the end of this PPT, that will have a proper distribution of everything. Then we can see this.
Sure.